It's time. It's time for part two. Harry Styles' first record, tracks 4 through 7. So this is part two of the Harry Styles. Well, this is all like a series, isn't it? Isn't it? So I've been kind of going through this woo of Harry Styles, as you know, and I decided to listen to the whole first album with you all. But I decided on the last video, part one. Actually, if you're watching this, is your first time seeing this little series thing, I'm going to put a card wherever. I'm not sure it goes in one of these places. So you can go watch part one, because you should watch this chronologically. Kind of like the way I'm doing the songs. I didn't really. I'm just starting to do it that way. But I think it'd be cool if you heard the first part. You know, it's already now I'm doing that thing. I'm doing that thing where I'm like, hey, it'd be cool if you heard it in order, just like you guys did to me, like in the comments. No, you should go to the first record first. And that's kind of what I decided to do. So first record, sprinkle in. I'm doing some bonus episodes of live performance stuff. This has been so much fun. Along the way, this has been great. Okay, so coffee today, no tea. I've been doing this Starbucks Veranda. It's really good. I'm a Pike guy. If you... Actually, I don't know. Did I tell you this? I'm a Pike guy. I like Pike. That's what I drink. But I made a mistake one day. I was at the supermarket and I bought a bag of Veranda. Now I'm thinking about, am I saying that right? I don't know if I am. Okay, so that's what I did. That's where I'm at. Today, like I said, Harry Styles' first album. I already did the first three songs. Meet Me in the Hallway, Sign of the Times, Carolina. I enjoyed those. I had my reaction, if you will, comment, whatever you want to say, review, whatever that thing is. If you don't know what I said, like I said, go back to the first video. I want to get right to this today. Stick around for the end of the video. I am going to do something a little different that I have never done before in one of these videos. So stay tuned to the end. It's not that big of a deal. Okay, here we go. This is Two Ghosts. Before he sings. You know, I always say I hate stopping at the beginning. I do it every friggin' song. I know. So, I'm pretty sure I mentioned on the last video, or the last, on part one of this series, that I like that there was a kick and a snare without any kind of cymbal work at all. That just happened again. And I'm going to tell you something. And I want to tell you this. So, Peter Gabriel, I feel like, is like the glue for all this, for me personally, getting into Harry Styles because of Sledgehammer and all that stuff. And in that first video, I loved when he was on Howard Stern and he said, you know, he thinks it's the best mix song. I went down that whole earworm of, you know, or black hole of explaining that, how I love that song and how that album's one of the best mix records of all time. One more thing of note that I want to tell you about Peter Gabriel and his brain, especially when it came to So. Peter Gabriel... He actually started as a drummer, like before Genesis. He actually started as a drummer, so he's an accomplished drummer. The thing is, he doesn't like to include a lot of cymbals, hi-hats, or any of that stuff in his songs. He thinks it takes away from it. So when he started that record, and on songs like, I believe it's Red Rain, he had Stuart Copeland come in, which you guys know. Big fan of Stuart. He's a friend of the show. And he had him come in and do some hi-hat work just because the producer of the album was like, I think we need some hi-hat in different places because Peter doesn't really like it. How it correlates is I feel like, I kind of feel like Harry has that Peter Gabriel mind a little bit in the way he approaches songs, albums, and stuff. And that's why me getting these links from you guys about that behind the album thing, that might be one of the things I'm looking forward to more than almost anything that I've been sent, because that's where my brain goes. I wanted to tell you that because this song right now, it appears it's just that kind of start, kick and snare. Second, did anybody else get a Wallflowers vibe? I sure did. And I love it. I love this. I love this style of music. It's just great music. It has a teeny weeny bit of country right there that I like. It's almost like the Eagles. The Eagles are not country. Sometimes they blur that line a little bit. And I'm not saying he's blurring it even into country. I just like the way that sounds. Gives me that vibe. Back road, country road, windows down, summertime. Feel me?
Same lips red, same eyes blue, same white shirt, couple more tattoos. But it's not you, and it's not me.
You know I love when he goes up in there. I've been saying it a million times. I'm starting to become a fan of that kind of voice he started the verse with. That's starting to hit me. I don't think I'm getting used to the high ones. They still impress me every time. Because just when he went up there, that made me feel really good. But I'm starting to like that subtle kind of thing he's doing right there on these songs. Because on the last, that live version of Girl Crush, you know, he was in that low register. I guess you could say I'm just becoming an overall fan of his voice. Everywhere it is.
Tastes so sweet, looks so real. Sounds like something that I used to feel. But I can't touch what I see. We're not who we used to be. We're not who we used to be. We're just two ghosts standing in the place of you and me.
Man, okay. When I saw the title of the song, Two Ghosts, I was wondering what it was about, how it would be written. That's beautiful. I mean, that's life right there. It's like, you ever hear the saying, a shell of your former self? It's like, we're just two ghosts of who we used to be. Okay, that hit me hard. I cannot lie to you. When like the chorus started, I feel like I smiled inside because I've been talking about his single track voice. And right there, when the chorus started, he double tracked it. And it just, again, it just hit me. I feel like there's something in each song that hits me. And that is the, well, I would say the great / dangerous thing for somebody like me, because somebody like me obsesses a lot about certain things. And that's the thing about Harry Styles. Every song seems to have that certain thing that keeps dragging me back. So right now, as I come back to this song, I will be looking forward to that double track when he hits that chorus. It's just magic. It's magic.
Trying to remember how it feels to have a heart. Fridge light washes this room white.
I really love those acoustics. Okay, I love that the two tracked acoustic guitars in the left and right. I've gone over that previously. It just sounds so full. It's just a great sound. Those harmonies in the background. Oh. Like that. Those are great.
In a glass half empty. Trying to remember how it feels.
Okay, so there I hear the hi-hat. Okay, so now we got the ride. The ride cymbal. So let me give some love on that guitar solo. A couple things. I love the way that it's mixed. You can hear some of that reverb in there, and it's just kind of got this, I don't know. It's just the way it sits on top of the music is so nice. I love the way that it's played. It's not the most complicated solo in the world, but it shouldn't be. That should not be one. It is, as I was listening to it, I was like, it was the perfect solo for that. Like, nobody could have done a better job placing that solo. Exactly the way it was. Okay, so the other thing too is it sounded like, let's go back to the spectrum, guys. So 200, psh, zero, right in the middle. I learned this. Okay, so I was down in Nashville, and I went to this producer's, he has his studio, and this guy is, he's awesome. He is so awesome. He is so, he is like so. What is the word I'm thinking of? He is where everybody wants you type of thing. He is. Be darned if I can think of the word. He is not wanted. What is the word? I almost feel like cutting this so I could go find a synonym for wanted. He is that guy that a lot of people want to get to mix their record anyway. And I actually may have mentioned this before. I can't remember, but I was in his studio and we were talking about guitar solos and I used to have them come out really far right or left to kind of differentiate for any other guitars going on. He's the one that was like, nah, man, I love to shoot them right out of the center or just off, but he loves them to come out of the center. Now, I would never question him because, you know, he has three dozen number ones. So that is not going to happen. But what I will say is I think I would like it off a little bit, off to the side. And what I think I heard was, until I go back and listen for sure, I feel like, okay, guys, remember the spectrum? I've talked about 30, 50, 75, all that. To me, it felt like that was 15 to 20, no more than that, is where they put that guitar solo. So it's shooting almost down center. It's not so far off in the speaker. And the reason why I think it's so important is because you have the stuff coming out of the center and then you have everything pushed off to the side. It's close enough to the center where it just warms the whole sound without taking anything away from the sounds that are in the center, like the kick drum, the snare drum, the bass guitar. Those things are inherently right in the center. Production. That, my friends, I know, you know, it's something like that, like a solo like that, that just drives my brain crazy that I love so much. It wasn't, like I said, it wasn't the most notes in 10 seconds. It's just the way it was played, those bends, you know, going in and out, and the way it was just sits right on top of the music. Gorgeous.
Not who we used to be. We're not who we used to be.
Yeah, that high
we're
harmony.
Just two ghosts standing in the place of you and me. We're not who we used to be. We don't see what we used to see. We're just two ghosts swimming in a glass half empty. Trying to remember how it feels to have a heart beat.
Right back to that intro, yes. That is songwriting. It's not just writing the lyrics. When you're writing these, the music, and you're laying everything down, you don't always go back to the beginning because you can't do it. It just doesn't work. It just doesn't fit. This, that's absolutely what that song needed to do. It needed to turn around to where it all started. That is great songwriting. It's a great song. Two Ghosts. Huh. Okay, so I'm four songs in. Dude, I cannot wait to jam this whole thing from the beginning. Aish. All right, so next up we got Sweet Creature. More acoustic guitar. I would have never thought coming into this there was so much of this acoustic guitar action.
Sweet Creature.
Show that voice.
Had another talk about where it's going wrong, but we're still young. We don't know where we're going, but we know we belong. No, we started two hearts in one home. It's hard when we argue, we're both stubborn, I know. But oh, sweet creature. Sweet creature, wherever I go.
I also want to stop just because that is definitely something you should get lost in his voice. I mean, you can. It's an acoustic in his voice. I've said this before on a couple of different songs. One time I did a thing for, I don't remember who it was, but it was somebody that I'm just on, you know, and they did a song and I know who it is. I'm not going to say it. Okay, so I'm good on. I mean, they're good. They're good. They're a good band. Anyways, they did a song, and I remember doing a review at Sound Vapors, and I was like, that vocal track is something that you, the rest of your life, you should just be proud of. And that's how I feel just listening to this, because it's like the, it's so naked, and he just crushes those verses. And I just feel like it's almost like he's not even trying that hard. I'm not saying that he's not trying hard. What I'm saying is it's just so effortless, and it comes out so, so very good. And it's just about the point he's about to do a run, something that's very poppy with his voice. And it almost like it backs off and just goes. And I feel like that's so much more appealing, because I think everybody always tries to show everything that they can do on every single line of every single song that they sing. I hear it a million times a day. Not a million, like five. But I'm saying is, I feel like that happens. And right there, that less is more thing, that's it. That's the line. That's the line I want to say. Less is more on that right there. He don't need to do any more than he's doing right there, because I think it would take away from the song. It's a gorgeous vocal that he's laying down, and it's full of sound, and it also has that singability where you know this guy can sing his butt off just by hearing what he's doing. Do you know what I mean? Sometimes you don't have to do that. It's like, that quiet confidence thing. And I feel like right now, from what I'm hearing, that's like, you know I'm bad. Let me hit you with this.
You bring me home, sweet creature, sweet creature. Bring me home.
Very nice.
Sweet creature.
The word sweet, that was sweet. That was so great right there. I want to mention those harmonies. They got this. Songwriting doesn't mean a whole bunch of stuff all the time. This is great songwriting too.
Running through the garden, oh, when nothing bothered us, but still young. I always think about you and how we don't speak enough. Oh, we started.
There's that little pop in the voice.
Two hearts in one home.
That little pop in the voice I've really come to love.
No, it's hard we argue. We're both stubborn, I know.
It's a great turnaround.
Sweet creature. Sweet creature, wherever I go, you bring me home. Sweet creature, sweet creature.
I like when he's going sweet creature. I like when he's saying that, because on creature, there's that, you know, that vibrato in his voice, and that harmony is the same. It's matching. It's just gorgeous. It's gorgeous.
Now run out. You bring me home.
Wow, I love that big cavernous harmony right there. And then him in the background, you know, filling that in with like screams or whatever. And it's great, great effect.
Just two hearts and one home. It gets hard. Stubborn, I know. But oh, sweet creature, sweet creature.
That is so good.
You bring me home, sweet creature, sweet creature. When I run out of road, you bring me home. You bring me home.
Just didn't expect so many songs like this. Wow, shit. Since the beginning of this whole thing, I didn't expect the rock songs either. This whole thing has been such a great journey, but knowing what I know, even what I know going into this first album, I just didn't expect this many acoustic guitars, especially the front of the album. I mean, I'm pretty sure I mentioned that too. I would expect it like a Only Angel or Kiwi or something to start it, but I don't know. I just think it's a great choice because it definitely locks you in. Okay, I was going to pause it to say something. What that was that last run of Sweet Creature, you know what really hit me? And I know you guys probably obsess over these songs and listen to them a million times, so you've probably picked up every single thing. This is my first listen. But really, at the end there, what hit me was they did not take those vocals from the other choruses and like copy and paste in, which secret is it's very common. So you take a great chorus vocal and you try. It's not that you don't try. It's not like a really laziness thing. You try to do it, but sometimes you just get that one and it's perfect. And you say, hey, let's just take all of it from here and let's stick it over into this next chorus part. That did not happen. I guarantee it, because the way he sung it was just a little bit different. And on that first Sweet Creature of that last run, he didn't vibrato the creature part, but he did the second part and then did that high arc right at the end there. He went up. I can't think exactly what it sounded like because it's already gone. But the next time I listen to it, I will be listening for that. Yes. Awesome. Right? Awesome. All right. I got mixed feelings about the next two songs, if you can believe that. I actually really do. So I'm fired up to listen to these two songs with you guys just because now I know these songs so well because I listen to them a lot. Only Angel being a lot. But a little bit, I'm a little bit kind of, see if you can feel me on this. I feel like I'm a little bit like bummed that I'm going to play two songs that I already know, even though I love them so much. Like I do, I love them, man, they're great. But what I'm saying is like, I just heard two songs. So Two Ghosts and Sweet Creature that I never heard before in my life. And it's cool getting to hear those for the first time and have those little reactions and the hair stand up and in different spots, you know? And I don't know. I'm not going to go too deep into it. All I'm saying is that it's very awesome. The next two songs we're going to listen to together. You know them. I know them. But what I mean is, experiencing them for the first time again is what I'm saying. I don't know. I don't know where I'm going. I'm on the merry-go-round. I'm almost getting there, right? It's almost back around. But, you know, up until this point, we've listened to, five songs together that I haven't heard on part one and the start of this part two. And that's fun. That's like part of the fun part, you know, is of doing that. So I don't really think I'm going to say too much on these next two songs because I've heard them. I might chime in here and there. But let's rock. Okay. Only Angel's up first. Oh, before I do that, I don't know when this record came out. I do know that's 2017, but it just seems like such a summer driving record. I love summer albums, right? And an album that you can put on. I like air conditioning, but I also like to open up the roof and then put the windows down and just, especially when I got a long journey, a long trip to go on, right? And I'm driving sort of fast and I'm petering on down the highway and I get a great album to put on. That warmness filling the cars, like, you know, and I got the stereo turned up way too loud because this guy get over the wind. I love that. I actually love that. And this album seems like that for me. I don't know. It just kind of feels like that. So I don't know when it came out, but it feels like it's a summer album. That's what it feels like. All right, let's go. Only Angel. This has been so great so far. God, this has been so good. Yes. You know, I just love this build-up. I said it before. I love this build-up. It's just when the music comes in, it's just so exciting. Like in my car, I'm just like, yes! You know, when the drums and the guitar... Did anybody tell me what that voice... I like that. Anybody tell me what that voice is? Is that something they did in the studio or is that from a movie or something that I don't know? Did anybody tell me that? Let me know, would you? I just love the song so much. Yeah. We'll be right back. It just doesn't get old, does it? Like, I look forward to hearing it every time. That pop. Love that. Let's turn that up. Can't help it, man. You know, I'll tell you something. I'll let this play while I tell you this. So, you got the song. You can hear it. So... it's hard not to listen. Okay, so sometimes when I was getting ready for like a show or a little tour or something like that, I'll have the songs that I'm going to put into the set list, and I practice those on my own, like with the band and without the band. So my little studio owl, go into the live room, and I will jam the speakers, get my electric guitar on, microphone and everything, and I will play over the songs that we're going to play, like over the recorded songs. Full on concert, you know? Like a great, if you saw a video of it, you would laugh your butt off. It's like the most ridiculous thing ever. But I also stick a couple other songs into that, air quotes, into that set list when I'm preparing for shows. It's all about, I don't know, cardio. It's all about getting ready. Because if you play a block of shows, I mean, you have to be in shape. Because I jump around a lot. I love to jump. I jump off an amp. I don't care. I just love to have, if I'm in the moment, you know. And you really get tired. You really get exhausted. This part, though, huh? All right, before it's over. So I will throw in a couple covers. So, you know, everybody's, you know, this quarantine thing, COVID and all this stuff. So there's no foreseeable future of shows or whatever for me anyway. Hold on. So anyway, I just decided I'm going to try to get back in shape just in case if a tour gets offered or I play some shows or whatever. So this long-winded thing, this rant I'm telling you is, I kind of started doing this song. I put this song in that little set list. So I'll be playing some of the songs I think I'd want to play live. A couple covers I like to throw in. Dude, I've been totally jamming this as a three-piece band. How I'd want to play it. And I've been singing along to a full blast. Because I'm in the studio, nobody can hear, so it ain't no thing. It's all soundproof, right? So, yeah, man, I got this jamming. And just thinking about, dude, I would love to play this live. This is the song I want to freaking, almost said that word there, that I want to jam live. So, there's that. I don't think I'll be putting that on camera for you guys to see here on YouTube. But, whew, that's a crusher. That is such a crusher. I love that song with everything I got. Seriously, and I'm talking about, there's songs I put in that set list, this little fake set list dream world of mine when I'm getting ready for a show. And most of the songs I never even put in the set. Some I do. I might put it like a Hoobastank or Incubus or something, some kind of song like that in there. A Pearl Jam song, probably Animal or something. But this is becoming one of those songs where I'm like, you know, because any band will tell you, if you play a show enough, there's songs that I just don't even really like to play anymore. Of my own that I've played too many times, but I know the people that come to see me anyway, they really love these songs. So there's a couple songs that, here we go. If I don't play it, I will get bombarded with texts, tweets, messages. Why didn't you play this song? Like as a joke, I paid money so I could hear the song, you know, like, literally like that happens. So there's songs I don't like to play, but there's also parts in a set list. Any band will tell you that you just look forward to. You love playing live. You love playing the whole show. But there's a certain part of every set list that I just can't wait to this song, till we play this song, because I always feel like if there ain't anybody that heard me before this or they heard of us playing this song, wait till they get a load of this. That's kind of how I feel with it. If I play some shows before this end of the year or early next year, I'm pretty sure that's going to go in the set. I just have to learn it so I can do it justice, because what I'm not going to do is get up there and just butcher. Let's go to the next one. This one too, though, right? Who would want to hear this live? For me, right here, just that would be the part I couldn't wait for. That is so wicked. You know, I've already thought about the amp I'd want to use on this. I'd want to pull out the orange for this song. The orange amp would sound so killer. Super hot, cranked all the way up. Yeah. You know the other thing I'd like to see? If I'm on a rock show, let's say I'm on a rock tour and it's like rock and roll, I can almost bet you most of those people in the crowd, if I surveyed them, they probably didn't listen to Harry Styles because they think it's not for them. They're wrong, by the way. And I'd love to see if we jam this song, just what happened there. Bam, 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 right there in the bridge. At one of my shows, anyway. I guarantee you people are jumping. Feet are off the ground. The crowd's doing that thing. And I'll bet you 90% of them don't even know that was a Harry Styles tune. I bet you. We should do this experiment. That's what I'm going to do. If I play a show, I'm going to play that song, and I'm going to make sure we get it on footage. And then at the end, I'm going to tell everybody. That was Harry Styles. Go listen to the record. I'm fired up. I want to play a show. Jeez. I said this. This is probably like the third video in a row I said this. I don't know what it is about it. It just makes me really happy. You know, it's like, there's this rock music that I don't get that happy about. And I think I said exactly this. It's one of my bands that I can't wait till they come out with a new record. Of course, that makes me happy. It does for any big fan. But some songs are just menacing. You know, you're driving, you're like, rah, you're pissed off, whatever. I'm not going to get into band names. But I think about, like, when I heard certain bands for the first time and how happy I felt. You know, I mentioned Silverchair because I would say that's one of the bands that every time they release something, when I listened to the whole album, I was just happy. Even on the depressing songs, I was just happy because of the craft of the songs and Daniel John's voice. And so the reason why I bring that up is because I got a DM from one of you, and I don't want to say your name because it wasn't on a public comment, but I guess I could have asked you, but I did not. Anyway, so I got a DM, and it was saying, hey, I saw you mentioned Silverchair, and it's a woman. She said she's a huge fan, Silverchair. And it's funny she went down this road because I was thinking the exact same thing. She was mentioning how she has those same feelings or something like that towards Daniel Johns, who's the lead singer of Silverchair. Go Google him. Go look him back in the 90s. And great look, great voice, great songwriter. Just was a really great, like, a front person. She kind of has those same feelings about him as she does for Harry Styles. I just James Bonded that, didn't I? Harry Styles. Actually, that would be Styles, Harry Styles. Whatever. Okay, so I when I read that, I was just, it was one of those things where I was like, oh, yes, somebody else thinks that too, because I will tell you, back then, Daniel Johns was like, he was one of those I wish I could be. Because I like the whole Silverchair vibe. I just like the way he wrote music. I love his voice. I loved his band. It was a trio, three-piece, and they rocked out for real. Like, and that's the thing. See, people say, oh, no, their later records, they got electronic, and they got some, you know, they got horns, and they got keys. So does Harry Styles on some of these things, and I'm telling you, I bet you that is the, I cannot wait to see Harry Styles live. I have a feeling it's going to be the same way it was when I went and saw Silverchair for the first time. When I saw Silverchair for the first time, and I keep bringing that up because they are one of my favorite bands, you know, they're not together anymore, but when I went and saw that show, it changed me. I was just like, that's the way a rock show should be. That's the way. These three kids get out there, skinny kids got out there and just killed it, crushed it. And that's how I feel the Harry Styles show is going to be when I eventually get to one. That's exactly what I feel. So anyways, that comment was like, that was so right on. I'm so proud of you. That was so awesome. And the good news for you guys is that you might go find something to listen to if you're taking a break from Harry. If you're going to listen to Silverchair, my favorite record is Freak Show. That is my absolute favorite Silverchair record. It's not even close. It's not even close. That top 100 I talked about, I'm not going to give it away, but that's very close to the top. Freak Show is. But another one of their albums also made my top 100, and it's called Neon Ballroom. That one, I would say that one has more pop on it than, say, Freak Show. Freak Show is just, it's kind of a grunge record, but Neon Ballroom took it to a whole different level, in my opinion. Even though I like Freak Show more, Neon Ballroom has something for, like, almost everybody. It's awesome. So maybe go give that a look. Okay, so I'm through 7 songs. The next episode, I've got 3 left. Ah, it's a little sad, right? Only 3 left. So we'll be doing tracks 8, 9, and 10 on the next episode. I mentioned that even if the next songs I hear completely turn me off, the album is still worthy of a top 100 for me. So you add these two that I heard new, 2 Ghosts, Sweet Creature. Not disappointed at all. Okay, so let's get to the thing I mentioned at the top of the show. I thought this might be a fun way to answer some comments. I'm going to answer some comments on this particular video that are on the last video that I put up, and that was the Girl Crush reaction. Now, I thought about going to the very first video. I think I've commented back to almost everybody on the first couple of videos. I think I'm probably behind a couple, but I'm getting there. Think about it, though. It dawned on me. I'd like to just answer you on here if you guys like that. I don't know if you like that. I'm going to do it on this one. If you hate it, I guess let me know, but I think it's kind of neat. I'd like to just, I feel like I'm talking to you back because on a computer, you're typing the words. I don't know. And then, you know, I get a lot of DMs and a lot of tweets and stuff. And, you know, it's like, there's a lot of questions and some people are curious about me. They're asking, you know, certain things like if I'm playing or touring or something like that. And I appreciate all those questions. I want to keep it Harry as much as possible because that's what this is about. That's why we're here. It's not here for me. We're here for Harry. But the thing is, I appreciate all the questions and I'm happy to answer any and all of your questions. So what I thought was, and if you have them, keep them coming, please. I mean, I will get to them. I'll answer you back. If I don't, maybe I'll do it on something like this. Maybe I'll do like a talkback show. You know, they used to be talkback shows. MTV even had them back in the day where a couple of VJs would get together and people would call in with their questions, like on an answer machine, you know, they didn't have it like it is today, but with the technology and everything being comments and, you know, social media, it'd be pretty easy for you guys to load up questions you want to ask or recommendations, and then I can get back to you in this form if you want to do that. Maybe you, you know, want to. So your names are on these comments that are public. So if I butcher any of your names, I am sorry. Seriously, because I know what that's like. It can be like annoying. Tommy's really hard to get right. All right, so I'm just going right to the top. Linda L, okay? So you said, I would love the behind-the-scenes video. Not a question, but you know what? Yes, there were a lot of comments saying, hey, yeah, we'd be up for that. We'd want to see a behind-the-scenes of like a Harry Styles cover. So yeah, I'm going to do it. I'm going to film it, actually. I might even get some help, somebody, a friend of mine, and maybe he can film it or something so it's not all static still camera like this is. But yeah, absolutely, I want to do it. I'm going to set up the mics and go through the process of how I do it anyway. So yeah, for sure. Okay, so let's get to this next one. It's Liesel, L-I-E-S-E-L. So I think I pronounced that right, Liesel. I like this guy. It says, did I hear you say you're a Pearl Jam fan too? Yes, very much so. If so, I'm really stoked because I absolutely love them. Me included. Have you done any of these reactions to any of their stuff? The answer to that question is I have not, but it's funny you should say that. I was thinking about, I do have Pearl Jam songs and albums ranked, of course, because I'm a freaking weirdo with numbers and rankings. I swear. Anyway, I don't even swear. It's just a fact. So I was thinking about going back to either Verses or Vitalogy and doing a run through and just do a listening with all of you, because I think it would be fun if there's any Pearl Jam fans. So I actually might do that just for the fun of it. Was it May Olivia React to Hairstyle She? That is definitely going to come. Weeble, you've been a loyal commenter and I see your name. I don't know who you are, but I love it. Please keep them coming. A lot of people have been, just so you know, the Graham Norton sign of the times, SOT. That get commented a lot. Yes, absolutely. That's going to be a bonus episode very, very soon. Also said yes to the behind the scenes cover. I think that's pretty cool. Sylvia Caldas. Again, hopefully I pronounce that right. I feel so bad when I don't. You're another person that said you kind of like the production aspect or these, you said that, you know, the technicalities and stuff. I appreciate that because I enjoy talking about it. And had you guys, if it was unanimously, like, we don't want to hear about that. We just want to see you go, dang, it's dope. I wouldn't do it, to be honest with you. Cause I like music. I love music. I don't want to see, and I'm not disrespecting anybody. Everybody has their own style. My style definitely, I know, does not suit certain people. And I actually get that. I understand. Cause I can be long-winded and stuff. I get that, but I like it. Mentioned She or Golden. Hey, Golden, I've seen that one popping up a lot. Can somebody direct me? Is there a certain show or something? Can somebody help me with this? What is Golden? Because I've seen it, but I don't know not exactly what it would. Sure. Colorful Souls. Yes. To the setting up and doing the drum cover. I appreciate that. Oh, I'm 35. Grew up listening to classic rock, mostly from 60s, 70s. All types of 80s music, 90s. Oh, Nirvana is one of my favorites. Okay, Beatles, of course. Here's another comment I want to say. I love the age range of all of these Harry Styles fans. I friggin' love this. It's, honestly, I'm getting tweets and DMs from people young that are like, I just love what you're doing, and I love that you're falling in love with Harry Styles. And then I have somebody that's 63 years old that only heard of Harry Styles a year ago. I'm loving that. Okay, Magda Jankowska? Okay, Tommy, but this is a live performance, not a studio version, so I doubt they did much to his voice. And it's possible. I mean, you might be correct. Here's my experience. All I can do is speak from my experience. So I've been on fairly big tours, and absolutely, positively, there's a mix. There is a vocal mix, even for nobody like me. I have a certain way I like my vocals mixed. So even as I'm doing a sound check on a show, I don't care where I'm at on the show, me and the sound guy, we'll have a little conversation. I'll say, I like it cut at this frequency, and I'm a nobody. Somebody like Harry Styles, absolutely. Absolutely, they're doing a vocal mix. They every tour that I've been on, and some really big bands, even the harmony vocals and stuff, those are all mixed. Those are all, because they have a tour manager. They have their own sound people that go with them to shows. And I've been on those shows where the sound people, they kind of take over the board and, you know, they like certain frequencies. It's the same way with guitar. When I'm dialing in on a guitar, that guitar just does not come out of the amp and that's what you hear. No. That does not happen. There are frequencies that each guitar player like. And if, depending how big your band is, you can tell, hey, I want the snare to crack like this. I want it to sound like this, the kick drum. So, yeah, they do. But you may be correct on this. They may not have touched it. I mean, you might be right. I mean, we could argue about it, but I don't know. You know, I don't think either of us know. But in my experience of touring with, you know, more than like a bar, like a real places, theaters and stuff, absolutely, yes, you do that. So, but thank you for commenting. That's awesome. Keep them coming. And thanks for watching. Okay. Nancy Rickett, she just, you know, I like these comments when people are saying that, you know, keyboardist on the first album and the tour is different than the one he has now, I believe, and stuff. And I love these little things. And I see a bunch of comments with that on there. But thank you. Keep those coming, too, because when I ask a question, sometimes people add to the comments. Sometimes they'll say, I think it's this, but she played with this person or that person, for instance. So we mentioned Claire and many of you sent me a message. I put out a KT Tunstall interview. I just interviewed her a couple weeks ago. That just came out last week. A lot of people let me know that Claire, gosh, I hope I'm getting this right. Claire has played with KT on her tours. And it was kind of like, it was one of those moments. I was like, I didn't mean that to happen, that all tied up in the Harry Styles universe. So that was sort of cool, right? So some of that stuff can add on when people leave comments. So please keep them coming. And yes, please do that. Here's one. Okay, from Lucy. He did this one acoustic and without a microphone in Japan. So if you want, and she gave me the link, enjoy. Smiley face, right back at you. Lucy, I appreciate you. That is so cool. I've seen that done a couple times. One time I played a show and singer went out there and a huge band and he just, all the music was stopped and he did that a cappella. And I was just like, I could never do that. That was so awesome. I'm going to get to more of these. I guess let me just do a couple more. So just because I, you know, Annie Panny, 28. I see you. I see you, dog. You commenting and sounds legit. Same thing. I see you guys. I appreciate you. I'm kind of getting, you know how I'm getting to know the people in Harry's band? I'm getting to know you guys and I really appreciate it. And I see you showing up on Twitter and stuff. So thank you so much. But, you know, you have these comments. They're very encouraging, but it's also getting to know you too. Because it's not just getting to know me. I'm getting to know you guys. But, you know, I get thank you for the episode. I really appreciate that. Next bonus, maybe Sign of the Times, Graham Norton Show. Yes. That is definitely going to be coming. But what I loved what Annie said was, if you want to do that behind the scenes, maybe Kiwi. And yeah, thanks for the suggestion on that. Because as we were just going through the album there, I felt like I want to, I'd like to do the front guy thing on that one, actually, and play and sing that one. But yeah, I wouldn't mind. Yeah, playing drums on that would be sweet. And then sounds legit. I just wanted to read your comment. Country and 50s music is sort of my guilty pleasure. That's cool. And I like that because I have a friend who's a big rock guy. I mean, screamo guy. And we were talking one day and he's like, man, I dig on some Motown. And he started bringing up like some great, great Motown artists. And we got in this whole long conversation. I mean, I'm from Detroit, you know, Motown Museum. Maybe I'll take a camera with me. And, you know, if they let me in, I can show you guys if you've never been to Detroit and went to there. And you know, and well, actually, I got another buddy of mine, Brian. Yeah, he actually knows more about Motown than, I mean, he might know Motown as much as I know rock music. And so I'm not saying that's a guilty pleasure of mine because that I'm out about that, man. I dig on some, are you kidding me? But I like that it's not always the same kind of music is the point I was getting to. Countries and 50 music, cool, man. I love it. I love that you listen to that. And just like I said, my screamo friend, I would have never guessed that he dug on some Motown. Would have never guessed it. He doesn't even have the vocal. It seems like the vocal acumen. I don't mean it as a diss because what he does is he's like one of the best to do that genre. I just wouldn't have guessed it. And so I really kind of love that. You know, I love that. Okay, last one I'm going to do on this one here. So Grace, 12052. 12052. Is that your zip code? No, is there zip codes 125? Okay, Grace, if you want to put on Behind the Scenes Set video, I think you should. As for the song, goodness, I would say Sunflower Volume 6. It's so diverse. It would be interesting to see you do with it. Okay, you've got me interested in seeing what that is. Sunflower Volume 6. Help. Help me, please. Okay, that's what I'm going to do for the comments today. And there's a ton of you. I want to get to all you. Actually, I feel bad. You know, that's the thing. Reason why I answer all these comments or like on Twitter, I want to interact with each and every one of you because like, I don't want to just do it to some people. I want everybody to be involved because I just appreciate you took the time to say something or comment or tweet. That means a lot. It's like you guys saying happy birthday. You know, man, it touches me right there. Okay. So somebody help me with Sunflower 6, Volume 6. Let me know what's up with that. If there's a specific video or live performance or what is that? And a link maybe. And I think going forward, I'd like to do something like this. So I guess let me know. That's the question of the video. So I always have a question. Would you like to interact like this? And I do a video where we're kind of going through comments, answering questions. And then, I mean, that may spur too many questions I can't even get to. I have no idea. This is uncharted waters. Uncharted, whatever the word is. I don't know which one it is. Territory that I'm about to venture into, I think. Because I really don't know. Or maybe I won't. Maybe you'll say, no, this is the worst thing ever. Because when I watch this back, this may have very well been the worst thing that I've ever done. And I get it, if it is. You guys, I think you come to know me. Stuff doesn't really bother me too much. I mean, I've gotten a few, you know, derogatory comments. It's all good, man. If you don't like me, It's okay. I always say, don't stick around if you like. It's even at a show. If I played a show, for most part, 99%, that was awesome, bro. You killed it. You might get people like, yeah, you guys suck, and it's okay. It's okay. What I found, though, most of the time, those are the people that stick around the most. They keep coming to shows. That kind of stuff. The world is crazy. So let me know what you think about that. I'm going to get out of here. This is such a long video. So if you've stayed to the end, I want to say thank you, because I don't know if I would have. I will be back. Actually, we're going to do part 3. That's coming very soon. It'll be coming very, very soon. But I'm going to do a bonus episode or two, because I have so many of these live performances that I can't wait to get to. Somebody sent me a DM on Twitter and said, I don't know how your willpower or whatever it was, you know, to that you're not going and listening to these. I don't know either, because I want to on a daily basis. So there's a part of me, I'm not kidding you, I almost said, I'm going to do one hairy video every single day. I might do multiple hairy videos every single day. And it was a little selfish, because I was like, because I want to hear it so dang bad. That's what I was saying. So anyway, all right, I'm out. Thank you so much. I will see you in the next video. Peace.